This is Dr. Akkerman. In this lecture on music business, we're going to talk about merchandising. Now, acts at all levels of success need to engage in selling product. At the lowest level, you're just selling CDs after your show at the coffee shop. And then maybe you progress into making t-shirts and bumper stickers or keychains with your names on it. You can get these things printed up at lots of local stores or through mail order, and you're just selling them out of a box off to the side of the stage, right? And as you progress, then you get a couple of friends to sit at the table for you before or after your concert, and you give them a couple of bucks while they sell your t-shirts for you. Eventually, though, as you get big enough, you might need more people to help you with this whole process of merchandising. So that's what I'm going to talk about. There's two main areas of merchandising: tour merchandising and retail merchandising. So first up, tour merchandising. Well, this is what it sounds like. It's the selling of merchandise on your tour. And typically, you're selling this stuff at a premium price because it allows the concert attenders to take home proof that they were there. It's a little memento. And if you've ever been to a concert and wanted to buy a t-shirt, you know, that's the most expensive t-shirt you've ever bought, right? Well, that's the idea, is that artists can really crank up the prices and make a little extra money on those concert tour items. Well, the artists at larger levels usually aren't incredibly hands-on with this. They've usually licensed the right to sell merchandise to a merchandiser, all right? And bigger acts will do this for a royalty. They'll usually receive about 30% or 40% of the sales price as a royalty. And that way they don't have to worry about the day-to-day handling of all that stuff. So a major act might even get an advance towards merchandising by going to a merchandiser and say, hey, we'll let you handle all the merchandising for our upcoming tour, and we only want 30 to 40% of the price, but you got to give us $10,000 up front. And then you can use that $10,000 to help pay for other aspects of the tour. Occasionally, merchandisers will get a performance minimum, meaning if you don't bring enough numbers into the concert, well, they didn't sell enough t-shirts, so perhaps now they don't have to give you a certain amount of money. They can keep some of the profits that they would have otherwise had to give you if you don't meet that performance minimum. There are also something called hall fees that will affect tour merchandising. So some merchandisers will just contract with each individual venue to handle the physical sales of that merchandise. So as a touring act comes into town, the merchandiser just backs a van up to the venue, hands all the product over to the local hall employees, who then sell the product. At the end of the night, the merchandiser collects up all the merchandise that's left over and the money that they get, and they will just pay the hall a hall fee for this service. And the hall might get about, again, 30-35% of that as their fee. An artist should try to maintain creative control of what the product looks like. If you are an artist, you don't want to have your name or your face put on just any piece of crap, right? You want to make sure that the t-shirts are at least a minimum quality, or that if it's a printing on some device, you don't want that to be able to just scratch right off. You want to make sure it's something that would last a little while, have a little value to your customer. So even if you are signing off the rights to a merchandiser, you want to maintain somewhere in your contract creative control of those products. The merchandiser will probably ask you for sell-off rights. Now, at the end of the tour, what if the merchandiser has got a whole lot of product left over? They ordered just a little bit too much. Well, they're going to want, but your tour is over. Now, where are they going to sell this stuff? They will ask for the rights to sell it off at the end of the tour to just wholesalers, to stores, whatever, to get rid of it. And you're probably wise to give them that ability, although you would certainly ask for something in return, like, well, you can't purposefully make too much product so that you can, you know, save a bunch of the stuff to sell afterwards. You've got to really only make enough for the particular tour. If you happen to have any left, then you can certainly sell it. But you have to do it within 6 months. Give them a time limit. And then say also, anything left after that 6-month window, you have to either destroy or you can give to charity, something like that. The reason is 6 months later, you may have moved on to another tour with a new merchandiser, and that new merchandiser wants to be able to sell the new product at full price. And if the market's still full of the older stuff at discount prices, then nobody's happy. Another thing that the merchandiser is going to ask you for is probably a fee to cover the security of looking out for bootleggers. Now, if you've ever gone to a large concert, a couple of blocks away from the venue, you may notice people standing on the corner selling t-shirts or bumper stickers or something that says the artist on the shirt. And maybe they'll, you know, they seem to be pretty cheap too, like, wow, $10, and it looks like a nice t-shirt, it's got a nice design, and maybe a person's picture on it. Well, you can almost guarantee that that piece of clothing with that logo on it was not authorized. The artist is not receiving their royalty off of that. That is a bootlegger selling unauthorized, illegal products on the corner. So the merchandiser gets hurt because, well, they're not selling as much stuff at the concert if people already spent their money on the way in. So they will hire security people to go out and, you know, surveillance the area and get rid of all these bootleggers. And they'll usually charge you, the artist, a small security fee in order to make that happen, because ultimately you'll make more money off of royalties if you accommodate that. Okay, the other side of merchandising is retail merchandising, and this is just all of the non-concert ways that products might be sold. Retail stores, the internet, mail order, the usual things like that. And these deals are made between the artist and what we call a retail merchandiser. Now, some retail merchandisers are simply just not quite big enough to handle every type of product that might get made, so they will turn around and sub-license out the rights to create other products, because if the main retail merchandiser really just does t-shirts, they may get a hold of some other company that does trinkets like keychains and shot glasses or belt buckles. And then they'll have another company that just does pencils and pens, another company that just does jump drives with your name on it, on and on and on it goes, right? Just walk around at Walmart and look at all the stuff that's got the face of a popular celebrity on it. You can imagine how many different companies got the sub-licensing to do that. So retail stores and internet stores, they will hand over royalties that eventually get to the artist of about anywhere from 15 to 25% of wholesale price. So this is like mall type stores that are selling retail merchandise that features popular artists on it. Now, a big box store, Target, Walmart, they'll probably only have to pay half of that in royalties, simply because they can move so much product, and you as the artist are probably going to see the wisdom of that. And then the other way retail merchandise is sold is through mail order. Mail order companies will license the right to handle your products for you in exchange for a royalty of perhaps 25%. And of course, that's 25% of retail as opposed to the wholesale cut that was seen from the in-store rate. So it's a higher rate of return for the artist. You're usually just not going to make as much off of mail order, so the rate is higher to try to compensate for that. So there you go. You've got two ways that merchandise gets moved out there in the world, either on tour or through the retail world. And ultimately, it's another way that artists, as you progress on through your career, can make a nice little piece of change on the side. We'll see you next time.